Good afternoon, the respected chief guest or the resource person of today's program in this webinar session, Mr. Mosham Bhattacharji, Area Director of Sales, South India at Park Hyatt, Kochi. He is in sales and marketing for a long time. And he has also worked in various hotels and convention centers. He was a part of team which launched the largest luxury convention space in South India in April 2018. And the same is already big driver for international conventions, incentives, and wedding businesses to Kerala. He has a formal hospitality management background with experience of over two decades in upscale and luxury hotel chains, with hands-on experience in account management, digital marketing, distribution, pre-opening, and ramp-ups in companies such as Sarovar Hotels, the Leela, Shangri-La, and now the Hyatt. I think we are having a very eminent personality today in the area of sales and marketing. And Mr. Mosham, we are having students from the Department of Management. We are also having students from Department of Hotel Management and Catering Science. We are also joined by the students of the management, that is the MBA, the postgraduate students of the management. And of course, some faculties have also joined. I think we have reached around 80 participants, which I'm hopeful to cross around 100, 150 in another few seconds. So I can see in your background, the beautiful place where you're sitting at in Hyatt, and you're facing, I think it's a lake. Looks like a lake.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes,
it absolutely. Looks like a lake, and it's so beautiful. I think the hotel itself is very, what do you call, inviting us to come to the hotel and stay there. So my dear participants, you are having a person who is who can share his real-time experience in sales and marketing. See, sales and marketing is a wide subject, as you know, whether it let it be the hospitality industry, or let it be a retail industry, or let it be the fashion industry, etc. The concept remains the same. It's only the product which changes from place to place. Here he is dealing with the hotel, but the concepts will be same in every industry. So I would request the students to listen carefully to the resource persons of this today's webinar session. As usual, at the end of the session, the students can put in their question and answer. They can type their questions in the Q&A. They can ask anything related to sales and marketing. So I think we are having a person who can answer all the questions. I would request all the participants to fasten the seat belts and start listening to Mr. Mosham. Thank you very much, sir, for spending your valuable time with us and also going to share your experience in sales and marketing. Over to you, sir. Over to you.
Right. So today we are primarily going to be addressing this topic broadly. And I have tried to make this session as casual as possible without having to do too much of serious learning and try to use as little jargon as possible. So I'll just quickly tell you how we will go about these sessions. We'll start slow. We'll start with some basics. We'll cover some basics. Like a snail will move and then pick up some pace like a tortoise. We will cover a little bit of in-depth about the basics that we'll initially discuss. Then we'll start to take a leap like an antelope and try and cover some details of the job. And then towards the end, we will look back and maybe I'll also help you answer some of the questions that may arise out of this session. You're free to ask me any other questions that are possibly not covered in this session that comes to your mind also. I'll try my best to answer them. My name is Mosham. I'm currently in Cochin. And as you can see, although I'm sitting in my office, but I've put up this background, which is right here. This is the villa of the Grand Hyatt Kochi, which has a small plunge pool outside, and beyond that you see the lake, Vembanad Lake. At the end of the session today, you should be able to answer these questions for yourself. You would be able to know about the role of sales and marketing department in a hotel. You would also know how this thing has really evolved over a period of time. And since I have been in the industry since the late 90s, I can kind of relate to how we started and how was it then to what it is now. So I'll try and take you through the journey. The journey primarily will help you to understand that how is it going to be really evolving by the time you guys are ready to take on the metal. And then we will talk a little in detail about the setup in the hotel. So how do we really adapt to the business of hoteliering, and how do we use sales and marketing in this, and what kind of tools do we use? And then if you are really interested to pursue a career in sales and marketing in hotels, then what are the options that you have? So this is what we are going to really cover broadly. And since I believe that the audience here has a vast, people from hotel school and then from management school, I'll try and keep it as less complicated as possible so that both the segments can really understand. So this is the traditional departmental format in hotels as it exists even today. There is the front office, which is primarily the front of the house. There is housekeeping, the department which broadly takes care of cleaning and upkeep of the hotel, both for the front side of the hotel as well as the back areas of the hotel, so called it. Food and beverage service, which is primarily restaurants and bars and banqueting, service of food and beverage. Kitchen or culinary team, which primarily cooks for service in the restaurants. There's an engineering and maintenance team as well. So the hotel is also has a lot of large equipment that we handle, from boilers to generators to air conditioning units. So all of that is primarily handled and taken care of by the engineering team. There's a finance or the account section, which is the money section where they collect money, make sure the salaries are paid on time, the vendors are paid on time, all the incoming collections are handled well, bank loans are also serviced. The security department, which takes care of the overall security of the hotel, looks after both the staff aspects as well as the guest aspects. Then there is, of course, the human resources, the department that is responsible from recruitment to training to making sure that people are in high spirits while they work. They work with high level of motivation, because a good motivated team also services guests well. And then there is sales and marketing, which we'll talk about in depth later. Then there's a purchase team, which is primarily responsible for purchasing materials. So since we process a lot of raw materials into cooked food, that's why the purchase team is there. Then there is information technology team, or the IT team. The IT team primarily takes care of all the softwares that we handle, both for starting from building maintenance softwares, to purchasing and inventory storekeeping softwares, to financial softwares, to even sales and marketing related softwares, to guest interface softwares. So that's broadly the 11 departments which is existing in the hotel format, as you all know. Now, what's missing primarily here are there are these smaller departments which are also to an extent revenue earning. There's the gymnasium, the spa, which are good revenue earners for the hotel, the laundry, which actually is a part of the housekeeping team, but there is a laundry department which in some hotels offered very large laundries, and they also service in-house laundry as well as they take contracts elsewhere. The transport department, some hotels have maintained their own inventory of cars and fleet and buses, so that they can earn revenues from the transport department as well. Besides that, to be able to exist in the ecosystem well, we also have a legal counsel, which is mainly an external company who handles the legal affairs of the hotel, tax consultants and auditors. So these all things also form a part of the overall hotel ecosystem. So if we go a little deeper, we'll see that there are broadly two aspects. One is the revenue earning aspect, and the other one is the support services aspect. So there are some people or some departments whose core job is to be responsible to make money by providing service. So these are the typical revenue earning departments of the hotel: rooms, restaurants and bar, banqueting or catering, spa, health club, transport, communications. Now, communications broadly cover internet these days, because telephone, which used to be a communication methodology earlier, is now kind of gone. And yet a few guests may want to make an ISD call once in a while because they have a problem with the mobile service provider. But the main communication today is provided by internet. Then there's laundry, and then there are something else also. Some people have, some people, hotels which are located near backwaters may have houseboats or speedboats. They may be doing excursions and things like that. So these are also different revenue earners for the hotel, directly or indirectly. And the support services to this team is provided by these departments. There's housekeeping. Housekeeping's core job is upkeep and cleanliness of guest rooms, public areas, back of the house areas, so everything. The culinary team or the kitchen team, they provide food that eventually is sold to restaurants, bars, and banqueting. The information technology team, I had explained that a bit earlier. The finance and accounting, human resources, purchase and stores, engineering maintenance, security, hygiene. Now, this is a very, very important part of today's departmental structure. There is a hygiene department in the hotel. Most hotels also have a hygiene lab. There's a hygiene manager who's a qualified microbiologist who's possibly studied in a food processing institute. He or she has a small lab where she or he primarily goes and picks up different food samples from different areas that are being served at the hotel, makes sure that they're contamination free, keeps a very, very close watch on if all the hygiene practices are followed while food comes into the hotel. Are they cleaned properly, stored properly, temperatures are maintained in the fridges at the correct level so that highly perishable items such as meat, fish and poultry are contamination free. So there is a big role that the hygiene department takes care of. In today's day, in the current COVID times, the hygiene department also has an important role to see that there is overall hygiene maintained by the people who are food handlers as well as people who meet the guests. So wearing masks, making sure that they wear gloves, making sure that they follow all the rules and regulations as being laid by different authorities are being followed. So that's very important. And then finally, we'll talk about sales and marketing. These guys are there to sell. They are there to primarily sell all the stuff that a hotel can sell. Like I said, the hotel can sell rooms, they can sell food and beverage to restaurants, they can sell food and beverage to banquets, laundry, everything. So these guys are there to sell. So how did the format really evolve? Now, I must be going back a couple of hundreds of years, or maybe even a little lesser, maybe 100 years. And there was typically hotels, lodges or inns. And then there were travelers, and the need was primarily a bed for the night to sleep while they are traveling. And that is how this whole business really started evolving. And their interaction was purely confined to the desk clerk or the front desk clerk in the inn. So a traveler would typically look for a hotel while he's looking for a night stop, and he would stop basis on the availability of a hotel, walk into the counter, talk to the desk clerk, find if there's a room available for himself or herself, and just check in and leave for one or two nights and check out the following day. There would typically be a small restaurant or a food option available in the inn that the person would eat out. But as and when the whole options of lodging went up and the number of travelers also went up, there was a need for this team to kind of connect between the travelers and the hotels. That's where the salesman kind of emerged. So he was the communicator of what products does the hotel have. Go and find the travelers and made sure that they found hotels whenever they needed them. Now, so the salesman was the bridge between hotels and travelers. And then as things got a little more evolved and complicated, there was two segments of travelers. There are actually two segments of travelers, people who travel for leisure and people who travel for business. So the people who travel for leisure had the option of either reaching out to the hotel or the salesperson directly or through travel agencies. And people who travel for business, who were a part of larger corporate houses, also had to reach out to somebody to negotiate and find out and finalize an accommodation for their travelers, for the corporate travelers. So they also were approached by salespeople. So then there was two things that the salespeople could do. And this is where I really entered the business in about 20 years back, is that we had very clearly identified corporate houses where we had to go to and travel agencies where we had to go. We had to go to corporate houses and tell them that, hey, listen, if you have 100 travelers coming over the next 1 year's time, please, this is the rate agreement with our hotel. Kindly make sure that all your travelers, whenever they travel to the city, stay with us. And this is what 3 or 4 hotels in their city used to do with different corporate houses. Based on the location, based on the facilities that they offered, the corporate houses decided which hotel they wanted to sign up. Normally, a corporate house would sign up with only one hotel, maintain loyalty, unless there was a big problem and they wanted to switch hotels. With the travel agencies, we used to go there and then talk to them and offer them prices. And these guys used to eventually package them and sell it outside. So that whenever a traveler, as in a leisure traveler, inquired for a travel to any destination, the travel agency primarily provided an MIMA solution that was inclusive of maybe airfare or train fare or a car put in, then hotel rooms, different eating options, all of that. So our package was sold to a travel agency. So our hotel, as salespeople are from the hotel, our job was to make sure that whenever a travel agency quoted for a client, they used to quote for our hotel and used to offer them prices. So that was very simple about 20 years back. We had two segments to look after. And then the internet came in. Internet pretty much came in. So when I started my career, the mobile phone was just introduced in the market. And it was 1998 when I had my first mobile handset. It was a thing of really a lot of prestige for us. So we were now, our clients could call us whenever they wanted to call us. Or they could pagers. We also had pagers. So the internet really changed things completely because systems become more complicated. Now the travelers did not have to go to an establishment to look for what they wanted. They could search for everything on the internet. Similarly, corporate travelers did not have to rely on their purchase team to find out which hotels that they could stay in. They could also look up in the internet. So the salesperson's job became a little more complicated. Because now he had to handle travel agencies, he had to handle internet, and he also had to handle corporate houses. How he had to handle internet is a long story. We'll handle that in the next slide. But it became a very, very big convenience for the travelers. They really found information available to them. They also found a method to check if the information that was being provided to them were correct or not. And the desk clerk was the hero a few years back, actually just went and sat inside the hotel and he just looked after the guests. His role kind of diminished. The salesperson has to handle 19 different aspects. The salesperson has to handle corporate offline travel agencies, which means those travel agencies, which was typically the shop that you see when you pass by on the road, those travel agencies, we still handle them because a lot of them are larger establishments. They move a lot of travel, a lot of tourists, different parts of the year from different parts of the world. So we make sure that we have attention of theirs. We have availability of our rates and facilities at any point of time with this travel agent. We handle this offline travel agent. Then there are meetings customers. Customers who are primarily looking at meeting venues to conduct meetings. We constantly are in lookout for those meeting customers. And a meeting customer could actually exist in different places. They could be the associations, for example, the Rotary Club of India, the Lions Club of India, or a Doctors Association of Cardiology. So these are typical meeting customers. They are conducting cycling meetings once a month, once a year, once in 6 months. And we make sure that these meeting customers has our product available to buy whenever they are in need of. This is one more segment that we look after. And then we look after the online travel agency. Now this online travel agency such as Booking.com, Make My Trip, and GoIBibo. These travel agencies have become very powerful because they are hosted on the internet. They have a reach that a normal offline travel agent does not have the advantage of. And they have customers coming from all over the world looking for all sorts of products, trying to find different combinations, making it for themselves to offer. So we make sure that from a distribution point of view, our hotels are available for these offline travel agencies. And then there are leisure customers. These guys are not completely banking on travel agencies, whether online or offline, to go and buy. It could be anybody. He just gets up one day on Friday and decides that he needs to take a break and go out with his family on Saturday and Sunday. And he's relying on information that he has currently collated through his friend, through some social media post that he saw in the past, through a colleague of his who just asked for recommendation. We have these leisure customers who are existing in small pockets who are looking constantly for experiences to go out on holiday. So we try and reach out to them. And then we also have to look after the search engines. So Google is constantly feeding out and churning out information and providing business avenues to hotels. There's Google and there's Trivago and then there is Kayak, and there are these kind of search engines where people are constantly seeking travel information. They're looking for airlines options, they're looking for hotel options, they're looking for dining options. So we also have to be present there and we have to manage them. And then finally, there are a lot of business customers who are not a part of large corporations. They are not a part of Tata's or Mahindra's, but they are small business customers who travel. Could be in the business of selling gold jewelry, could be in the business of selling textiles, could be in the business of exporting fishes. So we also have to reach out to them because they are also constantly traveling to meet their customers. They're constantly traveling to meet their vendors, and they are also traveling because they are also a part of some kind of an association who are conducting meetings around the year. So broadly, these are the different kind of segments that we have to handle today, which was typically just a travel agent and a corporate house at some point of time. So now, to be able to handle this entire complexity of our business, the hotel has also departmentalized or compartmentalized the sales and marketing department into small sub-departments or setups to be able to do specialist jobs. So there is a hotel sales team. The sales team's job is to go out and meet customers and motivate them. So they are the push guys. They are constantly going out to corporate houses, they're going out to travel agencies, they're trying to seek customers to tie up with them and provide them a committed volume of room nights. Then there's an event sales and planning team. The event sales and planning team's job is primarily to be able to take care of all the events or banqueting business that takes place in the hotel. And this includes business that comes in from corporates, business that comes in from different associations, and the business of weddings as well. So the sales team, the event sales team, are those teams who are primarily the sales interface when a customer comes into the hotel and inquires for a banqueting venue. And then there's a planning team. The planning team primarily helps the customer once the venue is finalized, when the customer has decided to take on a venue for a particular event or phase, then the planning team is helping him plan the menus, making sure all the decorations that he wants to be done is in place, make sure that the venue is ready for arrival of his guests, make sure that the guests are taken care of. So the entire planning team is helping the guests to run the or live the event experience. There is so much of digital marketing assets to be handled here. Now, when we spoke about online travel agents, when we spoke about search, when we spoke briefly about social, there is definitely a lot of customers who are planning to buy through the internet. So the digital marketing team is responsible to keep on targeting those customers, providing them content that inspires them, making sure that advertisements of their products pop up at the right time while they are in the research phase or in the dream phase to buy a product. So there's a digital marketing team. Then there's a consumer insights team. The consumer insights team is constantly looking for feedback and they're looking for details that helps to make the product better. So this team primarily is looking for what is the customer really talking about? What do they really want? What can we really do to deliver better stuff? What are they talking about when they're traveling from outside India? What are they talking about when they're traveling from one state to another? How is the need of a customer who's coming from North India different from a customer who's coming from the South India? What about it? How do we, what are the people who are coming for local weddings talking about? What are the people who are coming for destination weddings talking about? So this is the consumer insights team, which primarily gathers a lot of data, analyzes the data, and feeds up with information that is relevant in product prediction. Then there is a revenue management team. Now, obviously, we are in the business of selling inventory, and we sell a very, very highly perishable inventory. When I say perishable inventory, we sell rooms, and much like the airline seats, the rooms, if not sold today for today, cannot be sold tomorrow. Unlike a lot of other commodities, for example, a telephone, if not sold today, can be sold tomorrow. The telephone will not really expire. But the room, if not sold today, cannot be sold tomorrow. Similarly, even banqueting venues, a large banquet hall, if not sold today, cannot be sold for tomorrow. Now, selling that venue depends on a lot of factors. A, the customers want it, which is there's a demand for the venue. Number two, there's a demand for the venue at a certain price. Okay. And number three, there's a demand for the venue at a certain price, provided I'm available for the customer to buy. So distribution is key. I should be available when the customer wants to buy. So if I want to buy a product and I know that I want to buy a product, if I yet do not find the product when I want to buy, I will buy an alternate product. So that is the job of the team which handles revenue to price properly and distribution to be available in the right place. So the distribution team makes sure that in all the channels where people buy the hotel products, we are present adequately. And the revenue management team makes sure that we are priced adequately. We are not overpriced and we are not underpriced. And then we have public relations, the department which communicates, which talks. So the public relations department primarily deals with press, that deals with any sorts of magazines and looks out for opportunities where they can voice out about the products in the hotel. Now, this is fairly new to the industry, is a content creation department. Now, with so much of selling that has moved into digital space, there is a need constantly for good content, engaging content, so that people get inspired to look at the content and eventually make buying decisions. So typically a blank hotel room is not an inspiration anymore, but an experience that makes a person emotionally engaged with the product is an experience. So the content creation team is constantly trying to create content about such experiences, which then can be marketed by the digital team so that we inspire customers to look at buying our products. And then there is, of course, the marketing communication team. So anything that is done on the BTL front, any sorts of partnerships, collaterals, you know, there's a lot of stuff that happens on the marketing front of the hotel. So that is the role of the marketing communication team. So it's become really complex. There are about 9 to 10 different aspects of the sales and marketing of the hotel now. So this is typically how the hotel sales and marketing department looks like. There is a head of sales and marketing in every hotel, and this depends on the size of the hotel. A 500 room hotel has a different kind of a departmental setup as compared to a 200 room hotel, to a 500 to a 50 room hotel. And also depends largely on different brands and how they want to perceive and handle this business. But ballpark, this is how it is. So there's a sales and marketing head, and there's an events team, there's a sales team, there's a marketing communications team, and there's a revenue manager. And under the sales, under the events team, there are event managers who look after the sales, there are event managers who look after planning, and there are event managers who look after weddings as a business, because weddings is a big business, wedding specialists. In the sales team, there are sales managers who go off to the corporate sales, there are sales managers who do travel agency sales, and there are sales managers who do associations. Under marketing communications, there is digital marketing people, there are public relations people, and then there are content creation people, mainly handling content for social and digital media. And in the revenue management team, there are distribution managers, and then there are analysts. That's how our sales and marketing department applies. Okay, so I have crossed two stages of my discussion so far. I've crossed the snail phase. I've also crossed the tortoise phase. Now I'm entering the antelope phase. here, I'm primarily going to take you through the entire cycle of how the business really begins and how does it really go as a cycle. So there is a product or a brand that decides to enter a certain market. And I will demonstrate what I say with an example when I go to the next slide. The first thing that we do is we do a consumer analysis. Find out who are the consumers in that market, available in that market. Then the next stage that we do is we go and do a competition analysis. We go and see out that what are the different kinds of competition that are already there. Some primary competition as well as some secondary competitions. And then we do an internal analysis. We try and see that what are the core strengths, capabilities that we are going to come into the market with? What kind of resources will we bring into the market? So we do an internal analysis. And based on these three information, we try and build differentiators. We try and build differentiators, which is how we are going to be different from the competition and bring a new experience or a new product to the market. And then based on the differentiators that you want to build, that we decide, we start to build on capabilities. And once we have built our capabilities, we start targeting. We start targeting to reach out to those customers with the promise that we have a certain amount of level of capability that we have built, and we want to offer that to the customer. Then we start targeting. And then as we start targeting, obviously that results into business. So then people who come and utilize our services, that is where we deliver the promise that we kind of came out with in the market. And then we are constantly collecting on-site feedbacks from them. We are looking at different kinds of online reviews from them. And then on the basis of that, we go and realign our product and make sure that we are understanding what the customer needs and then going back and targeting again with our realigned product. So this is that cycle that kind of goes on. And we create a cycle that initially used to be a long-term cycle. A cycle used to be created for 10 years. Those things have now reduced to 3 years. So when we create a product capability that is going to last, we normally keep that capability in mind that the capability will become obsolete in 3 years' time. So it's become more and more dynamic because the customer needs are changing, and that's why we are adapting it ourselves. So when we create a new restaurant concept, keeping in mind that we will have to be changing that concept in 3 years because the voice of customer will actually lead us to change it again, because that is how it has been. So to demonstrate this with an example, I'll take an example of this particular hotel that I'm calling out from, Grand Hyatt in Cochin. It's located on the Bolgatti Island. We inaugurated in the month of April 2018, and we had a fabulous run in the first couple of years, and till this year in February, and then all of a sudden the COVID thing came in, and then we are currently now slowed down quite a bit, but we are now gradually recovering with the relaxations that is provided by the government, and we are sure that if things are as progressive as it is, as it looks now, we will be back into business properly again from the next year. So when we looked at Grand Hyatt as a product, when we did a customer analysis, we found out that there is a lot of customers who are looking for business meeting venues, who are looking for venues for family leisure, and who are looking for venues for wedding experiences. So those are the three things that we found out from our customer analysis. Then we looked at the competitive landscape here in Cochin. We looked at the presence of brands like the Taj, Marriott, and Le Méridien. And then there were some other secondary products. There were homestays, and then there were these boutique hotels. So there was this huge competition landscape that was already there. So we sat down to build our own product capabilities and human capital resources so that we could provide something different from the competition to our customers. And we started to create these unique experiences for each and every segment of customers. So a unique experience for the wedding customer, that he gets expansive banqueting venues as many options of venues that he wants to. He wants to do a morning function in a particular venue, he can do it in a particular venue. He wants to do an evening function in an outdoor venue, he can do an evening function in the outdoor venue. He wants to go to the lake, he can stay and do an event on the lake. He wants to go to the helipad, he can do an event at the helipad. So we created a lot of options for the customer to choose from, which is a big differentiator from what the competition really offers. Similarly, when we looked at a family leisure customer, we made sure that that there was enough options for the children to undertake in the hotel, starting from dining options. So we had different kind of crockery and cutlery for children, so that's more colorful and interesting for them to look at. We looked at play areas for children. We made sure that there was outdoor play zones and indoor play areas also. There were cycling tracks. They could play volleyball. They could play basketball. They could have a game of archery. They could go cycling. And there were so many options available for kids to enjoy themselves with. So when we looked at customer business meetings, we obviously came up with a very high level of technology, technological competence as compared to the competition. We already built in-house capability on technology. We also had good vendors, not just from the local area, but international vendors available if anybody wanted a solution that was not so easily available in India. So we looked at that. So that is how we built our capabilities. And then we looked at good quality of talent, including both in the delivery side and also in the sales and marketing side. And that's how we built our, and that's how we went to the market. So when it came to targeting these customers, we looked at different options. We looked at the online space. We looked at the offline space as well. So we spent a considerable amount of energy, time and money making sure that we are visible as much as possible on the digital space. We did a lot of BTL activities, not just in Kerala, but in India and also all over the Middle East, because there's a large amount of customer base in the Middle East who comes into Kerala quite frequently. Our sales teams reached out to pretty much all the corporations, larger corporations allowed in the available in the country, and we took a lot of time to do that because we wanted to reach out to everybody as much as ground we could cover. And then there was a high spate of advertisements that we did then and we continued. So we spent a lot on targeting, and it's an ongoing process, which obviously resulted in sales through the rooms, through food and beverages, and events, spas, other experiences. We keep on conducting internal surveys with our guests. So every guest who stays in the hotel receives an online survey. He fills up, he speaks about his feedback on the surveys. We record that and we use that to introspect on what we could do to make our product better. We also are constantly listening to what people are saying on social media, in TripAdvisor, in Instagram, on OTA sites. And based on all of this feedback, we realign our products so that we are ready for the next set of customers. So that's the way the current cycle is. And this is how typically a business goal for a sales and marketing person looks like. Our job is to increase the average room rate. Our job is to increase engagement on social media. Our job is to increase RevPAR, which is revenue per available room. Our job is to increase market share. Our job is to increase average per cover, which is how much do you spend on F&B per person. Our job is to increase revenue per square meter and event spaces. So these are the different kinds of business goals that sales and marketing team typically works on. And the fun part is, you can travel the world wherever our business belongs. So I guess pretty much everybody in the team here has traveled to different countries in the Europe. They've traveled to different places in US. They've traveled to different places in Asia and Middle East, because this is where mainly our business comes from. And this is where we go and connect with our customers. It's a 9-to-6 job, pretty much unsaid, 5 days a week unsaid. So you still have a good life. It's a white collar job after. You get to meet a lot of movers and shakers in business. So we normally have our meetings with the CEOs of companies, with owners of different businesses, and you name it. So unlike a lot of other industries, people who work in the hotels actually get to have first name contacts on the phone books of top CEOs. You always look the best. You're wearing the best suits and saris and business suits whenever you're in the job. So you're always looking dapper. you are responsible to take decisions of the hotel's revenue future, not just short term but long term. And that's a big decision, because the entire model of the hotel, the entire financial model of the hotel for an owner, is pretty much controlled by the sales and marketing team as to how they really position the hotel and deliver business for the hotel. You also get to dine in fine restaurants like guests with guests. This is the better aspect, the fun aspect of the job. Those of you who are interested in looking at sales and marketing as a career option in hotels, you could be you could join the events team. All you need is a hotel degree and maybe 1 or 2 years of experience in F&B operations, where most people start their career with. For people who want to join the sales team, it's important that you do an MBA or a BBA, and you join as sales coordinators or executives depending on how much of past experience pre-MBA, BBA you have. For people who want to join marketing communications, we normally prefer mass communication graduates with an understanding of populations and branding. For people who are going to join revenue management, we also look at people from BBA, MBA section with high skills on data analytics. And so this is how anybody who's currently in this audience can look at a career in the hotels industry in sales and marketing. Now it's time for questions. I've done a lot of talking. Do let me know if you have any questions. Okay, so I have a question here. I can see it says that, what are the traditional format in hotel revenue part? I must have covered this in a bit towards the initial part, but I just sort of recap. The revenue management team is responsible for two aspects. One is pricing and the second is distribution. Pricing, decisions are made based on how the market is priced and demand and upcoming demand. And the distribution part is handled basis on the cost of distribution that is available across different channels. Now, a hotel room gets sold through an online travel agency, or what we call is the OTA, for example, Make My Trip. The same hotel room could also get sold through the brand website, so Hyatt.com or Marriott.com. The hotel room also gets sold from GDS or Global Distribution System. This is the same system that the airline companies had created to be able to make sure that all airline products are available in a consolidated platform for any agent to visit, pick, and sell. Later, it also started to have options of hotels. So even that traditional format exists today. So we are also available on the global distribution system of airlines. So broadly, these are the three unseen platforms that a hotel room gets sold at, besides the seen platform, which is through a corporate, through a travel agency, like I said, or a guest just walks into the hotel and buys. So the revenue manager's job primarily is to make sure that we are available to sell at the right price in all these formats. Our placements are correct. It's the same thing how we go to a retail store and make sure that our Hindustan Liver product is always available in eye level distance as compared to any other local product, because they make sure that they're available for the customer to choose from whenever they want to buy. So that is the main job of the hotel revenue and distribution. And it's quite complex.
Participants, you have any questions or any clarifications on sales and marketing? Please put it in your Q&A box. Even any faculty has got any doubt on the thing, you can ask. I think there's one more question which has come, which say that, when do you see the things falling in place, keeping the present scenario in mind?
Well, I love this question, and trust me that I must have tried to answer this question a million times already in the last 5 months. I don't have an answer. However, progressively, how we are seeing things is that people are adapting to the fact that COVID is another disease like cholera or dengue or malaria or tuberculosis, and it is going to be with us for some more time. So immediate requirements of business are being conducted, immediate requirements of entertainment and leisure are being conducted, immediate requirements of wedding are being conducted. So anything that cannot be pushed to a date are all being done. And we hope that the vaccine will be out sometime soon, and hopefully by the same time next year, we should be back to normal. But one thing I must tell you is that nothing has really stopped, trust me. Hotels are, there are new hotels also opening, and we have two hotels in the pipeline which are coming up and they are likely to open in the first quarter of next year, which is between Jan and March of next year. We also have a lot of recruitments going on in different hotels across different countries, because this is the time that people are trying to align their businesses and trying to see how they want to move forward. So nothing has really stopped. Well, I want to answer that question. It's very very nice and my favorite. So I have started my career when we were really much in a snail pace. You know, we used to come to work and decide what has to be done today. Okay, meet that customer. He's not been met for the last 2 months. I think we must go and meet that customer. So we started at that pace about 20 years back. The number of hotels were little, very very little. Indian economy was gradually opening up and business was aplenty. So we are now in a phase where we are pretty much glued on 24/7. Timings really are not 9 to 6, but it's pretty much 24 hours. We are on our phones all the time. Customers are asking us questions, not just on emails, on WhatsApp, on Instagram, on Facebook, on software that we have not heard about. So this is the journey that we had in this business, from a snail tortoise to currently an antelope, maybe you're already flying. But what is really motivating in this entire journey is the change that we have seen over a period of time, and things really change every 5 years. And I hope that things are going to now change every 2 or 3 years. So that's interesting time ahead for you. So very good question. How do you handle rejection? You know, so, There are two ways of looking at this. One is being personal, and second is being business. So in the initial part of our careers, or when I meet my teammates who are youngsters, they have a different way of looking at rejection, and we have a different way of looking at rejection. So we spend more time on planning to be able to handle rejections well, and that's what we mostly do based on the examples that we get now. During my times, of course, when I was a youngster and I used to get a lot of rejections, I used to be first depressed and then we used to go back and introspect what really happened. But these days, we spend a little more time on planning. The tool is really available with us. So earlier, we used to go to a customer first and then learn about him. Today, we go to a customer having already made a first contact with him, after having known his education background, what kind of links do we have? Do we know anybody else who knows him? We've already made a recommendation. We made a couple of comments in one of his social posts to get some kind of a recognition, so that we are not really meeting unfamiliar people. People really still do business with people they're familiar with. So the ratio of rejections are lesser if you prepare yourself well. Yeah. So it's basically about which is more important: strong visibility of the product or closing the deal. Please, we may know. Don't you think that ultimately it's all about money, right? So what you're doing to create visibility of the product has to eventually result in closing a deal. So both are important in their own aspects. There's another question, which is, what is that the industry is looking for me, from me, a candidate who wants to pursue for a career in sales and marketing? So what primarily when we are looking for people in our industry, we are looking for people, A, who have at least understood the business well. And you need to do a lot of reading to understand the business well. When we meet most candidates these days, they are ignorant about the fact that how does social media result in selling? How do consumers decide to buy? Who are the different type of customers for different kinds of products? You cannot be selling a Levi's jeans to everybody. It doesn't fit or suit everybody. So how do you target products based on demographics in the first place? We need to basically have an understanding of do your understanding. And if it is not necessarily for hotels, for any product for that matter, if you have that understanding, I think you're ready to be hired. How do we market a hotel service? So we market a hotel service through the AHAS, which primarily we use a lot of customer voice to sell. We use a lot of testimonials to sell. And that is why in the current days, we encourage our guests to talk about their experiences where we can sell. So that is really how we market a hotel service. And the initial phase before we meet a new customer, it's completely dependent on the salesperson's commitment or the brand's commitment. So we have a lot of brand commitment that goes into creating reliability for the customer and the willingness to buy. And that is starting point. But then at the end, we definitely are constantly looking for testimonials to them. AHA is the keyword.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. I would request the Dean Management and Commerce, Dr. Merlin, to propose the vote of thanks.
Good evening to one and all present here. So, respected secretary of this prestigious college, Dr. Ajit Kumar Lal Mohan, the special guest Mirji, area director, sales, Grand Hyatt Kochi, head of the department of catering science and hotel management, Mr. Jayan, faculty members of our prestigious institution and other institution, participants from our own college and other college, this gives me an immense pleasure to propose this vote of thanks. Really, indeed, this is a very great session. So our secretary is always keen in conducting such kind of valuable sessions, which gives a great insight and a mind-blowing sessions for our students as well as for the faculty. So this session is not only, so this is considered to be a very useful and informative intellectual session for the commerce and management students. On behalf of our college, I would like to thank the special guest of this day as like adding a feather to our institution's achievement. Today is a great day and this achievement will keep on going with a great manner. And really, once again, I would like to thank the secretary and the guests, the faculties and everyone who made this event a great success. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your time.
Have a good day. Enjoy yourself. Thank you.